Metro Manila. Through the years, it has become the prime financial, commercial, social, cultural, and educational center and seat of the national government. Its cumulative development through the centuries has built a solid foundation for it to become one of the most competitive megacities in Asia. In 2005, according to PricewaterhouseCoopers, Metro Manila, with 11 million population, is ranked as the 42nd richest urban agglomeration in the world, with a gross domestic product of $108 billion. Now, it is a megacity with 16 million population and has become the 28th largest economy of all urban agglomerations in the world, and the second in Southeast Asia. It houses some of the biggest establishments in Southeast Asia, such as the Bagong Nayog Lupino, also known as Entertainment City, and the well-known Mall of Asia. For the past 10 years, the megacity had its ups and downs in economic, spatial, technology, and the urban developments. And right now, the government and some private sectors had set their development plans in motion. But among these plans, which ones would be sure to succeed? Will these plans help the city's progress as intended? Or will they do more harm than benefit? Hop in and together we'll see Metro Manila, the past, the present, and the future. Metro Manila is a place of economic extremes. Most of the rich and upper middle class in the country reside within gated communities or subdivisions in places such as Forbes Park or Ayala Heights. Other wealthy families opt to live urban lifestyles and own large apartments and condominium units such as those in Rockwell Center in Makati and the Fort Bonifacio Global City in Taguig. The fact that the area is populated by many of the wealthiest people in the country has also driven up the real estate value of the properties in these areas, and because of this, condominiums are being established left and right all over Metro Manila.
First of all, there is a demand. It's not demand supply. It's a revenue generating because on the other hand, on social dimension, there is some risk of problems will be generated. The connections, our local networks we can expand. So, more people, more waste generation, more utilities demanding, congestions, and more people, more services, so it could not cost money on the city to provide these services.
Condominiums are not the only ones rising all over Manila. One big project is also coming up, and what's more, it's not on land. It's gonna rise on water.
You are invited
to the future with us.
This is Manila 3000. A place for living and a place to live. A place for art, where monuments will arise to showcase the proud traits of the Filipinos. A sustainable city with renewable resources for uninterrupted power and communications, clean water, and food supply. A city that never wastes, with specially engineered waste-to-energy facilities. Manila 3000, sustainable and operational 24/7. Through the summers and storms, making Manila a city of the future.
However, the establishment of this project isn't as faultless as it looks like. According to Professor Geoffrey Cueto from Mapo Institute of Technology, though the project sounds good, it still has its own bad sides.
Construction of new buildings play as a catalyst for economic development. It could give you good side and also bad side. Bad side, because of course, when there's development, there's an invitation of innovation. The third thing, more possibly, there'll be production of waste, production, and of course, it heightens pollution. Also, it will worsen congestion, traffic movement. That I think most urban planners don't want to see in a particular way. I have to believe that whatever you take from the nature will go back to the nature. So, I'll go for the presentation. I'm not against economic development, but I'm after for sustainable development.
As what Professor Cueto said, whatever you take from the nature will go back to the nature. This has happened countless of times throughout the history of the world. Mother Nature has shown her wrath to the humanity for being irresponsible and greedy on the use of the world's resources. And here in our country, when we talk about the wrath of nature, the most common form are storms. And in a region like Metro Manila, storms will always bring one big problem: flood.
We just have a small improvements for our structures to prevent flooding, and like the improvements of drainage only. For the government, their plans is to improve the drainage systems that we have at the moment, and to put up structures that will prevent flooding, such as. They have a proposal to put a small dam at the upstream portion of the Marikina River that goes through the Pasig River and to the Manila Bay.
But even though countermeasures against flood have been being developed through the years, flooding in the city still remains to be one of the biggest problems in Metro Manila. The question now, will all these plans in improving flood control systems and structure, is it really possible to make Metro Manila a flood-free region?
There's a possibility because we could measure the amount of rainfall. We could measure the amount of flooding that could go to our city. So if we can measure, we can also estimate what dimension of flood control system we could have. If we have the knowledge of engineering, we have the resources to construct it, like cement, no? The aggregates, but the issue there is economics and maybe politics. Because it would be very expensive to construct big structures to control flooding. But yeah, we could have a zero flooding.
In terms of technology, Metro Manila has also been taking steps forward at its own pace. Nowadays, public free Wi-Fi spots can be seen around bus stops. Toll gates are now being automated. And now, there are electric-powered utility vehicles roaming around the city, and one of the most known among these is the Comet Jeep. The Comet stands for City Optimized Managed Electric Transport. Its design and technology was made by the US-based Pangaea Motors, LLC, and it's exclusively distributed by GET, also known as Global Electric Transportation, a partnership of both American and Filipino private investors. There will be designated stops where these 20-passenger electric shuttles can pick up and drop off passengers and recharge their batteries. The lithium-ion batteries require less charging time, more or less 5 hours to be fully charged, and last longer than the lead-acid batteries that some electric vehicles are still using. A single, full charge is estimated to take the Comet 80 to 100 kilometers, and just like with the MRT and LRT, passengers will use cards to pay the fare. More importantly, so as not to lose the multicolored, kitschy-designed Jeeps have become world-famous for, Comet owners may even design their vehicles outer appearance. The Comet must have given the people good impressions, but it would actually be just wasted without a good road infrastructure.
Our road seems to be densified every day by day. The growing numbers of vehicles is very tremendous over the day, guys. Meaning, there are lots of vehicles that is coming in Metro Manila. That needs a road space for them to travel. Otherwise, they need a parking spot. But you look what happened to EDSA, Spania during this particular specific day, wherein Spania looks like a long parking stop. Lots of events. Because our infrastructure of home currently cannot 100% handle the demand of the vehicle to travel from one place to another.
That is why, to remedy this issue of traffic, the government has set a long-term project in motion. Introducing the Mega Manila Dream Plan, a doable, long-term, integrated transport infrastructure development for Mega Manila. Using transport as a catalyst for sustainable urban development, the Dream Plan aims to put an end to traffic congestion, households situated at high-risk areas, mobility barriers on the road, excessive traffic costs that burden for low-income groups, and air pollution. Although this plan may have given excitement to the people, we still need to keep in mind that it's a long-term project. This means a lot of possibility, either good or bad, may occur between the span of its development. And if in case the project has been successfully indeed,
successful project, should I say, should carefully consider the needs for road infrastructure or accessibility or mobility of vehicles, because it will play important role on the exchanges and the trades and other developments that will further affect you, the totality of a particular.
Creating this documentary film has given our team experiences leading to different insights about what Metro Manila's future will be 10 years from now. A rising economy, 0% flooding, a solution to the effects of climate change, a continuous flow of traffic, in short words, a sustained development. These are the things that the future Metro Manila will be holding, but only if the current plans and ideas for improving the metropolis will be carried out properly and successfully. Although, even with all these plans achieved, problems will surely still rise in the future. Shortage in power supply, problems in clean water supply, an overgrowing population, and some other problems that are yet to be envisioned. That's why, to the future engineers, architects, chemists, scientists, programmers, professors, doctors, businessmen, CEOs, and other professionals who seek continuous improvement in life, our team has a rather undemanding challenge for you. Make the future happen!
Cause everything is never as it seems.